get on your feet and welcome Michael Angelo Batio.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. It is so great to be back here. I'm a graduate. I have a degree in music theory, and I minored in composition. I took piano. I really loved it here at Northeastern University, and I've had a really fantastic career that has never ended. I'm on the road until the 21st of December this year, and I have toured 58 countries around the planet. Now, I know there's over 200, a little bit over 200, but I've been to many of these, for example, China, 11 times. I've seen more of China than most Chinese. And so, but I never, ever have taken it for granted. I get to travel and I get to do all these great things because I can play a guitar. And we were talking earlier, I've toured everywhere. I've been to Mexico so many times, but I've never been to Acapulco, Puerto Vallarta, Cabo Wabo. I go to Guadalajara, I go to Mexico City, I go down to Puebla, I go to places that are kind of like the Cleveland, Ohio's of Mexico to tour, but I have seen so much of this planet. And being that this is my alma mater and it is a university, one of the things that I tell people, I get to do seminars in addition to concerts. And there's that old Nike commercial that said, just do it. It's pretty cool. I like it. Just do it. Sounds good. But I'm not exactly a big believer in just doing something. I have a different way. Here's the Michael Angelo Batio modified version. Just finish it. See, I found when I was a little guy, when I worked on a song, I'd finish it. And I found so many times in life, people don't finish things. They start a project, they put it away. It was the same thing with school. When I came here to Northeastern, I had a few goals. One, I wanted to totally embrace the college, the university environment. Two, I wanted to get good grades. And three, I was going to finish. That was it. I wanted to get the degree because without finishing it, and I didn't know this at the time because I don't think, you know, I wish, you know, it's the old age. I wish I knew now, you know, then what I know now. But I realized finishing things is something I've done my whole life. After I graduated college, I moved from my hometown of Chicago straight to California. And I didn't have a goal of, well, I think I'm going to like be in a band, man. I think I'm going to do something. I had one specific goal. I was going to get signed to a major label. That was it. And I'm not saying this works for any of you. I've never had plan B in my life. Plan A is the only plan I've ever understood. It took almost 1 year, but I did it. I got signed to Atlantic Records, which is a division of Warner Brothers. They're huge. Led Zeppelin was on that label, many bands. But the reason I'm saying this is because when I finished school, what I've learned over the years is one thing. There's an old saying that you can't teach an old dog a new trick. That's only true if that old dog doesn't know how to learn something new. And I found the single most important thing that has kept me viable and active in my career is I can learn. That school gave me the ability to learn things. Because when I graduated school, you know, the quote, the real world, unquote, there's a lot of things here that prepare you for that world, but there are things that aren't, that no one could ever prepare you for. And I found, for example, if I listen to anything from Eminem and Tech N9ne to Bon Jovi or to Queen or to Mozart, I can listen to it as a fan and I can turn on my music theory ears and analyze something so I understand it really quickly. And it's helped me a lot because a lot of times I hear this, oh, back in the old days it was so much better. Well, I have my dad's cell phone in my office. It's like this big, it's bigger than my car battery. The thing, it's the reverse of Zoolander. It's like, hello. And then you've got this little curly Q cord. Oh, that's cute. And then it's got a 10-foot long antenna. Okay, now, I don't know about you. I got the big iPhone 6 Plus, 120-something gigs. And I remember people saying, it's big, dude. Yeah, it's this big. It's not a battery. Hello. And so, you know, how much better was it back in the old days? I don't know. You know, I beg to differ. But I know this, that I constantly listen to new things. That doesn't mean I like everything, but I listen. And I listen to all styles of music. And it has really, really helped me because I don't fall into that trap of just stopping to learn once I got out of school. Now, why am I saying this? In addition to you know, I've had a lot of things happen, a lot of accolades and won awards and things, but I also used to teach guitar. Before I moved to California, and when I went to Northeastern, I was a guitar teacher and I was a session musician. I used to do Burger King, Taco Bell commercials, you know, when the bacon's frying in the pan and the guitar went clink, a lot of times back then, that was me. And so But what I did was this. I also taught a very famous student named Tom. I used to teach up in Highland Park. I used to just take 41 right to Peterson and get to school. So anyway, what happened was I was at a music show in LA, and I see this guy come up to me, and he's like, "Thank you, Michael." I'm like, "For what?" He goes, "Well, you were my student. I mean, you were my teacher." And I go, and I'm looking at him, and I know who he is. I didn't realize Tom, at that time, was Tom Morello from Rage Against the Machine. And so he was my student. Who is he playing with now? Bruce Springsteen, not too bad. And so, and he does so many things. But, and then I've released instructional DVDs. I'm a writer in Guitar World magazine. Pick up the brand new issue right now. You'll see my column in it. I like to teach. I like to help. I've always wanted to help people. I wanted rock music to have the great guitar playing in it, like jazz and like other, and like where you hear great violinists and orchestral music. So, why am I saying this? I wrote songs, I've released DVDs that people all over the world have learned from my things, a lot of famous guitars. I've worked with Mark Tremonti from the band Creed and Alter Bridge. I've jammed with their singer Miles that sings with Slash right now. John Petrucci from the band Dream Theater, Michael Romeo. The list goes on and on and on. New bands like Trivium. Anyway, why am I saying this? This next song you're going to hear me play is one that I wanted to show on a DVD, an instructional work of what I was going to teach you in 3 minutes and 45 seconds. And then you get to see the old me playing with the new me. So here we go.
Thank you.
Thank you. People ask me, why'd you do that, man? What do you do that for? Why not? One thing I did learn in school, too, from the time that there was a person that could beat a stick on a log, there was another person who could hit it just as good and twirl it. And so what I learned, whether you were Mozart or Paganini or even Beethoven, you did things visually. That doesn't mean you have to run around and do cartwheels, but even Beethoven with his wild hair, he looked and acted like a rock star. Paganini was the highest paid musician of his time because he had a strange demeanor. It was a very rock star attitude that he had to his music, the way he portrayed it, the way he played. Mozart, when he was a young boy, you know, a super genius, but he used to have fun, and he used to be able to put a cloth over this little instrument called a clavichord, and so he would enjoy the performance. So I thought, work for them, work for Elvis! It works for a lot of people. So, and I found that when you can put great music together, because that's always first, and you portray it some way, visually, you have a really good chance of getting signed and making it. Now, I have released 12 solo records. I'm a very prolific writer. I like to arrange other people's music. I like to do a lot of things. Also, towards the end, we'll have a question and answer. Does anyone have any questions for me? No? Good. I like to talk. Okay. So anyway, but I've written a lot of music, and I also love to do arrangements of other people's music, where you heard me do the Randy Rhoads version on the first song. This is my song called Rainforest. Now, Brazil is a really great country. If you've never been there, I highly recommend it. I have a 10-year visa to Brazil. I like it. And I'm going there to tour again for the 7th time in October of this year. But I normally sit in I sit in the aisle seats. I don't really care for the windows. But the first time I flew to Brazil, I got stuck in a window seat. And from Chicago, it's 10 hours to Sao Paulo. It's a long way. So it's 5,000 miles straight south. And so anyway, I'm watching and I see this big expanse of forest and nothing around me for as far as I can see, the rainforest. So I was working on this song and it's instrumental. And one of the things people ask me too is, Michael, why did you title that song what you titled that song? I'm like, it's Rainforest. It's my song! I can call it what I want. And it is instrumental. So you're not hearing me going, Rainforest, Rainforest, it's raining in the forest, Rainforest. Although I could score for that. But I think you would rather hear me play it instrumentally. Here is my song called Rainforest. Let's do it. Thank you. Thank you. This is something that I do myself, and I don't, again, you know, this is the world according to Mikey. I don't call shows gigs. I don't like to play. Those are kids' words for me. It's the music business, not the music game. And I found out very early that I have a lot of sayings, and I've done this from just teaching guitar, just the way I like to speak. When I said in my first instructional video, I'm going to give you the keys to the Lamborghini. And I meant it with guitar. But I also have another saying, one of many. You can't think outside the box unless you know what's in the box. See, because it's, you know, we live in a, I'm very internet savvy. I have Macintosh phones, Macintosh computers. I'm very good with Windows. I've got an Android tablet that we use. So I'm familiar with both platforms. I prefer Mac just because the way my mind thinks and for music. But that doesn't mean that Windows isn't great. But I use YouTube like I use MTV. See, because when I was coming up, when I graduated from Northeastern, I really worked hard on being the best student that I could be. You know, I always thought to do your best, to no matter what, and I was going to graduate no matter what, and I did. And that was the goal. But it was also the goal to learn a lot because I love history. So in addition to understanding music theory, I took a lot of classes where it was just to understand composers, and I had some great, my teachers, most of them were doctors, and so, and I had one in particular that I really enjoyed the way he taught because he had visited a lot of the European countries, and, you know, we talked about organs, you know, that Bach, Johann Sebastian Bach had played on, he had seen them. And so, to me, history was fascinating, and that's what I do when I go overseas. I've seen so much of this planet, and I make time to see things. For example, you know, when I go to China, I've seen the Great Wall. I've climbed the Wall of Heroes. That's bad. I mean, I don't know who designed those steps in China, but they didn't figure. It's like one step's like this, the next one's like this. It's like somebody drank a little bit too much Chinese beer when they were designing that thing. And so you're climbing it like a mountain. You're like, it's literally like climbing rocks. And then you've got this crosswind whipping at 50 to 60 miles an hour. There's this one part called the hero, and you better be on your toes, literally, or you better have somebody hold you, because that thing can knock you off the wall. And so just things like that, or seeing the terracotta soldiers, thousands of clay soldiers in China, just wild stuff like that. I've seen this all over the planet. I stood 1 foot in front of the center stone of Stonehenge. You know how many people get to do that? Not many. But we played an auditorium on tour there several years ago, and a fan that worked at the Stonehenge, they pronounce it like Princess Stonehenge Museum, he came to the show. And so I got to do things that like a lot of people don't do just because of a guitar. And again, I've never taken it for granted. But when I said you can't think outside the box unless you know what's in the box, school and my education helped me to understand because, for example, music theory. What is music theory? Johann Sebastian Bach did not learn theory. Theory was invented afterwards. It was an attempt, and a really great attempt, to understand why he sounded so great. And when I was in school, I actually took a modern, like a 20th century composition, one, you know, within, you know, modern comparatively. I analyzed the Beatles song Blackbird. If you take the two-part guitar writing of just the Beatles song Blackbird and put it up against Bach two-part writing, it's virtually identical. It's that good. And that's why the Beatles are remembered. So I said to myself, okay, why do we in school still play Bach, Beethoven? Now when you see the VMA Awards, it's mostly pop music, but people don't know how popular the guitars, the electric guitar especially, and guitar is the number one most popular instrument on this planet. I tour in India, 1 billion people. I tour in China, 1.3 billion. We're the third most populous country, I think, or right up there in the top five. But people all over the planet love guitar. They love rock music. They love American music. They've embraced our tonal system. Because in China, they don't use our tonal system. Their Chinese music is not based on our system. Neither is India. But they like it. Neither is Korea. But they like ours. So our tonal system covers the entire planet. Not because we force fed it to them. People like it. They like the sound of it. It's very pleasing. We've had thousands of years to develop it. Bach, with his well-tempered clavier, set us on the path of well-tempered tuning versus mean tone. So anyway, all this stuff, it makes me think, okay, I know what's going on before me. I've seen how these people operate. There's no two composers that write alike. There's all these variations, but there's familiar themes. There's the box. So I understand this. So I said to myself, how can I do things that are different? Okay, we have people that write great music. Well, I write great music. I've got 12 albums. I've been on Warner Brothers twice. I've got songs in movies, video games. I've acted in movies. If I had a checklist, I was just on that metal show, that big VH1 show this year. I get my music's out there, all of it. And so I've got that part of it down. But what I did was once I started to develop my show, then because people from the past have done it. And another saying, don't reinvent the wheel. Learn what came before you. Learn what's going on. Because, again, especially in this stage, it's so easy to criticize. It's easy to sit in a chair and go, yeah, it sucks. I mean, we see it on the internet all the time, the toxicity. People can write great things. They can write really bad things. When you put yourself out there, you're going to have 99% people that love you, a lot of you, maybe 90%. I get 90% plus on every video I put out on YouTube. But there's that 5 to 10%, no matter what I do, they're not going to like it, whether it's me or anyone else. Any artist, whether it could be a Bach piece, Bach sucks, I like Mozart. It could be anything. But people are like that. There's people that like it. Don't worry about the ones that don't. But just know this, if you're a chef, if you want to be in business, you're gonna have some people that don't like it. And you know what? You're in the company of the best people on the planet, because they've said that the Beatles were never gonna make it, that Led Zeppelin couldn't, Rolling Stone magazine said Led Zeppelin can't write. They said Kiss were clowns that will never make it, they will never be popular. Nobody remembers the critics. They said Franz Liszt overplayed. And so from time began, there's going to be somebody who's great and somebody who's gonna criticize it. So what? But I learned this. Another phrase, always a student. I never, as great as I am of a guitarist, I always want to learn new things. And the way I learn is what I learned here, what I learned in school. You look at what's happened in the past. You look at what you learn here and apply it to keep learning. Because your whole life, if you continue to learn, you have a big advantage, because your learning curve is like this versus some idiot that says, no, 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 this sucks, this sucks, this sucks. It's easy to say it sucks. You get up here and do it. You invent a double guitar, you do it. And so that's the thing. And so I wanted to be different because my heroes were different. And so that's where I came up with this, and I came up with my double guitar. But I learned, and here's what I learned about rock guitar. See, when I was growing up, even though I studied jazz, I liked metal music. I did. I liked Black Sabbath. I liked these heavy guitar bands. I just liked it. And when I would play jazz songs, and I played in the jazz band in high school, girls didn't like it that much. Then I played a rock song and all the girls are like, oh, I like that. Especially when you had a good looking singer. Hey, baby, come on. And I'm like, yeah, yeah, yeah. You know, I was like, this rocks. And so what I did was I started to study other bands. I'd go to see concerts. I used to see a bunch of concerts here before they remodeled it. I saw this great guitarist, Elliot Fisk, for the first time. He's amazing. And he's older now, but it's the first time I'd ever heard him, a classical guitarist, play like I thought a violinist could play. And I knew Andre Segovia. I knew other classical guitarists, but I didn't really know Elliot Fisk, and now he's super famous. But he played here on this very stage, and I saw him when I was in at the university here. So anyway, but I loved jazz, and I loved heavy rock. Those are the two genres I like the best. I like to listen to George Benson, then Tony Iommi from Black Sabbath. And so I used to like put on Joe Pass. I put on Django Reinhardt. Then I'd listen to Judas Priest. I mean, I just like different things, like the iPod generation. And so what I did, though, was I did this because my mom. See, my mom liked Elvis Presley. She liked the Beatles. She liked B.B. King. She liked stuff like that. I hated them all. I hated them. And my dad said, listen to B.B. King. He goes, every note's on his face. And I go, so what am I supposed to do if I use a wah pedal? Dad, go. You know, and so then my mother goes, I want you to sit down and listen to an Elvis concert with me. Watch this. I go, I hate Elvis, Mom. She goes, watch it. I'm like, no. And so this went on and on. Finally, I said, okay, I'm going to watch this. So she puts on the video. And I'm watching this dude. He's in jet black leather. He's got big, thick black hair, sideburns bigger than the state of Texas and New Mexico put together. but the guy can sing. I'm listening to him. I don't want to like him. The two metal horns don't want to go up for Elvis, but I'm watching him. Girls are like, oh, whoa. My mom's like, isn't he handsome? And so, and I'm looking at him going, I want to think that he sucks, but he doesn't suck. He's really good. And he looks cool. He's got jet black leather. I'm thinking, you know, this guy's dressed like he could be in Judas Priest. I'm like, okay, I can get this. But he could sing high. He could sing low. He could sing raspy. He could sing clean. He was perfectly in tune. He had soul. He had it all. And then I watched his guitarist. And I'm thinking, that's not the way guitar players look. You know, he's standing around like this. And I realized, too, that from that era of Elvis, a lot of those guitar players really weren't rock players. They were jazz guitarists that started to play rock. Even their tone was jazz. And so in the early days, and I hated it. Not jazz, but I hated the way they look like this. And I'm thinking, this guy looks like a dweeb. You know, I was like, look at this. And so, and then I realized what changed is that it took a British guitarist named Jimmy Page from Led Zeppelin to go, you have to lower your guitar 1 meter, about 39 point something inches. And then Jimmy Page set a new low, holding a strap for rock. So you had in the 1960s and 70s, guitarists like this versus in the Elvis era, they played like this. Even the Beatles, watch how high they played. Then they started lowering it and being cool. And so then in the 1980s, in the LA scene, you had all these bands like Motley Crue. And then in the 1990s, here's my impersonation. See, in rock music, now the guitar players are every bit as virtual. They're virtuoso players in rock, just like there are in orchestral music and jazz. There weren't when I was growing up. That was the goal. When you listen to young rock bands today, the playing is better than it's ever been. They have this technical music, or even me, I write in a lot of mixed meters. They do very technical things with this heavy distortion sound, but they're technically really great. That's where I came in. I tried to elevate the level of rock guitar playing, not the music. Music is different. It doesn't take a great player to be a great songwriter, but it takes a great player to play Rachmaninoff. I mean, let's face it. You know, he was a great composer and a great musician. And so I wanted the musicianship to be equal to the composing of rock. So after this, in the 1990s, rock music kind of went astray because they stopped doing guitar solos and all this angst. So here's my impersonation of the 1990s rock guitarist in America. We don't do guitar solos, no solos, no solos. Wait, I'm in a punk band. And I thought, this is the worst. It's the worst. And so I said, you know, it's a big world out there. I'm going to Europe. I'm going to Australia. I'm going to Asia. And so I said, hey, if the rock music wants to go on that level, fine. Thank God it's 2015. Because there's so many great players and so many great genres. Just go on satellite radio and just listen to about 37 to 40 and listen to some of the great, there's Octane, you have Liquid Metal, there's some really, really great stations out there. Why am I saying this? I loved and I studied rock music the way I studied Bach and Beethoven. I studied Led Zeppelin. I studied the Beatles. And I just, it's not that the Beatles are my favorite band, they're not. I appreciate them, I admire them. But when I analyzed Blackbird and I realized this, there's a reason we like them, because their music is written as well as Bach, that particular song especially. Some of the melodies, like the song Norwegian Wood, they're beautiful. And so there's a reason, but it's also the reason that young kids, my 13-year-old nephew, is in a school for really smart kids. But he plays guitar, he loves it. He sits there and plays a Rocksmith game. He's shooting aliens with his guitar. He loves it. He likes listening to Avenged Sevenfold, Born to Be Wild. He'll listen to all styles of music. He likes everything, and he's a gamer too. And so, I'm just hoping that his uncle helped on that. But I learned, and I realized, always a student, because if you know how to learn something new, then you can become, for your entire life, you'll still be active. There was an architect, Frank Lloyd Wright. He was designing buildings and designing things well into his 70s. Tony Bennett had a number one album with Lady Gaga. He's in his 80s and he can still sing great. Why? He learns. Who is he? He didn't do a duet with Elvis, you know, which Barbara Streisand did. They took the music and you know how you can do it, Natalie Cole. People have done that before with her father. And so, but he took a younger artist. And so what you do is you learn. And so no more talk. Here is my version of one of my favorite heavy metal bands growing up, Led Zeppelin. Let's do it. Thank you. Thank you very much. Before I play, I have one more song to play, but it requires two guitars. And I wanted to do something that no one had ever done on a guitar, and I did it. I used to, like I said, I studied jazz guitar when I was a kid, and I realized, you know, I liked extreme musicianship. Like, I like extreme virtuosity. I just always have loved it. But I also like pop music, too. I like, you know, there in music, singing is different. You can be, you know, a classically trained singer, but a lot of pop singers, especially younger ones now, can sing a lot of things. And it's funny too, and they also too, like my nephew went to a rock camp, and because especially with rock music, some of these vocalists could sing extremely high, really high. So to try and copy them is not such an easy task. Can you hold that? Hang on with the double for 1 second. But what I wanted to do is this. I wanted to do something no one on this planet had ever done. And growing up in Chicago, when it was 75 below in the wintertime, helped a little bit because, as you know, in the wintertime, what are you going to do? And so, you know, I mean, when I lived in L.A., I mean, you know, you could basically go skiing in a swimsuit. And so, you know, we don't have that here, but we have a lot of other things that are a lot better, like water. And so, but it's true. What can you say? I actually did that. I used to live in Woodland Hills. I lived in LA for a long time. And I'm at Woodland Hills by the pool, chilling. Lived in, you know, right off the 101 in Canoga. Gorgeous area. I call up my dad. I'm like, Dad. You know, it's in December. I'm getting ready to come home for Christmas. And I go, Dad, it's 75 and sunny out. And I knew it was below zero with the wind chill here. And he goes, you can laugh all you want. He goes, you might have sun, but we have water. And I go, yeah, Dad, but it's frozen. And he goes, it's gonna melt, kid, it's gonna melt. And so all I know is this, but I love growing up in Chicago. I moved back, I have a nice house here again. But when I got the idea for this double guitar, it had nothing to do with rock at all. I watched a jazz concert with a jazz saxophonist. He was an elderly guy at the time when I was still a kid named Rahsaan Roland Kirk. And he was blind, he could play all these different instruments, and I'm watching him just tear it up on the saxophone. I'm like, yeah, man, yeah, and he's going crazy. And then he puts two saxophones around his neck, and he's playing like this. And he did this thing called circular breathing, where he could breathe in and out at the same time. I'm like, that's wild, man, wild. And I could draw good. I'm a good artist too. I think when you get talent, it comes like in bunches. You know, I didn't get the talent to be a great singer, but I toured with Pink. She's not too bad. And so, but I work with a lot of great singers. And I'm a good background singer. I can sing a tune, I can sing the parts, but I don't have that lead voice. I think you're born with it. You either are or you aren't. In fact, my professor here, when he heard me singing, he goes, you're in a rock band, aren't you? Well, yeah. And he told me I had my tonsils taken out. And he said, you hear the notes, you have control issues, right? And I said, yeah. And he said he didn't know why, because people don't take their tonsils out. You know, doctors don't do that to kids much anymore, but they took mine out when I had tonsillitis. And he said that he's seen this with a lot of singers, that it affects your vocal cords, that it changes something, even though we don't really know what the tonsils are used for. They're not really used for a lot, for anything that we know of, but they're there, and that taking them out changes something in your voice, because that's why I could write. I hear it, but I don't necessarily, I can't sing it quite as good as I think I should. My dad had a really good voice. I should have a good one, but he said it was my tonsils. I don't know, I think maybe I just wasn't quite, my dad said, you can't be born with everything. And so, but here's what I said. When Rahsaan Roland Kirk did that, when I was a kid, I said, I'm going to do this on guitar. But it's not like two pianos. I got the idea for the angles by, of all people, Edward Van Halen. I watched a Van Halen concert, and I was working on my double guitar, the initial designs, and I had the necks going straight out. Little too biblical. And then what I did was, you know, but I'm thinking about it. This looks, you know, shoot him. And, you know, it looks like a bow and arrow or something. And I didn't make it yet. I'm just drawing it. And then I saw Van Halen, and I watched Eddie play like this. And I'm watching him, and I realized humans don't play guitar perpendicular to their body. They play in an angle. And I said, what is that angle? So I took a magazine, a photo of him, a full-length photo where he's like this. I took tracing paper. I flipped it around, and I took a very simple thing called a protractor. I put the protractor down, and I measured the angles. And it was roughly 110 degrees. I mean, you think 90 degrees here, it was like this. And so what I did was I said, that's the way the double's gotta be. So then I started drawing it like this. I had the very first one made at Dean Guitars that was here in Chicago. They were a Chicago company. They had since, many years ago, sold the company, but they are still a USA-owned company in Tampa, Florida. My very first original double guitar, the very first one, used to hang in the Chicago Hard Rock Cafe. Then they moved it to the Tampa Hard Rock Casino in Florida. It's in a really cool place. There's Kid Rock's there, Rush, a bunch of other people. They have really great memorabilia at this. But it's in a really cool section, too, by this main entrance, by this pool area. Anyway, you can see it if you go to the Tampa Hard Rock Casino. But I wanted to do something that was never, ever, ever done. And I did it. Since I've done this guitar, a guitarist named Steve I, fantastic guitarist, a friend of mine, did a version of mine called the Heart Guitar. The Pick of Destiny, the movie. Jack Black did a version of this guitar. Type in Michael Angelo, you don't even have to use Batio, Jack Black. And there's an interview saying, you know, where did you get the idea for this double guitar? And he's like, yeah, man, there's this guy, Michael Angelo Batio, he's going crazy like Jack Black can only do. And so, but he talks about my guitar and where they got the idea. I was in a Kia commercial a couple years ago and they were doing all those like Motley Crue was in one. They hired me. I'm in the middle of the desert. It's this like dry lake bed in California by Ontario, California, filming, you know, with the dust bowl. I mean, it was unbelievable. Like we were covered in dust every 15 minutes. Looked like an old Clint Eastwood movie when they brush off the uniform, you know, and you think it's, you know, Confederate and it's actually blue underneath, you know, I mean, it was crazy how dusty, but I've done a lot of things with this guitar. Now I'm going to play it for you. So no more talk, here is the double guitar. Now, if you've gotten anything from this kind of workshop performance, one, education is good, very good. Two, I think you have to have faith in yourself. You have to believe. If I know for myself, if I believe in something that I'm doing, I can sell it. And I don't mean sell like a salesman, but if I believe it, it doesn't really matter to me what anybody says. I'm successful at it. Because if I believe it, I can be successful at it. The third thing, align yourself with other very smart people. Brian's got a master's, okay? He is the one who set up the video for me. I've learned a long time ago, I'm great in certain areas, and the things that I'm not great at, I have other people that are better than me in their areas. So do I have to worry so much about video? No, because Brian's brilliant, so he worries about it. And then, and that's why we were able to interface everything. Part of this is Northeastern's set up, that big video screen. Part of it, we bring our own. But anyway, I'm gonna check this real quickly just to make sure. All right, we're good. Anyway, are we set, Brian? Okay, no more talk. The double guitar. We'll be right back. Thank you very much. Now for the engineering part of it. Where did I get this guitar strap? I can only say this, like at a seminar. Saxophonist. It's a regular guitar strap put around my neck like a saxophone, so I have access. The other two thing about this engineering, it never was one guitar. It's two guitars. And this is the way it was designed from the very beginning. And I even designed the case. I have a patent on this string dampener. What it does is it blocks the string. So when you're in the recording studio or if you just want to do some really intricate things with an electric guitar, sometimes the amp makes it muddy. You put it down and it enables me to play both at the same time. Anyway, I want to thank the people here at Northeastern University for having me here. And I want to thank Northeastern because if it wasn't for this university, I wouldn't be here today. So thank you so very much. Thanks. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you. Thanks. I'm going to take a couple minutes and then I'll stand outside if anybody wants to talk to me after, you know, it's a meet and greet. But again, we have some of my CDs and DVDs, or I felt almost embarrassed talking to you about that, but they are available. Again, thanks so much for having me here. I'm Michael Angelo Batio. Good afternoon. See ya.